tend to ignore that or tend to look at it in a form of an awareness. Not at all. Please do not do this. Right? So, you know, today I just had a word with my one of my colleague, right, who have been, you know, taking up my this classes and all, and he had attended these kind of sessions that I've been taking. Right now, there was a misconception that I found that many people do think or they do pretend that when we talk about cyber crime, we just have to talk about cyber crime. It's not the actual case, right? Mm-hmm. And why I'm you know actually bluffing this topic all of a sudden random today is the fact that I've observed that we do think in this way, right? Whether like what we do is we think cyber crime is just talk about the tech terms, the digital terms, collecting the volatile memory and analyzing it using some open source software such as Autopsy and all. This is not the way we should think in terms of when you are learning about cyber crime. Then make a thing clear that you are talking specifically about forensics, because when we talk about specifically about cyber crime in general, so we, before adding the term cyber, have to understand the term crime in general. Then come to the point, cyber crime, right? Because again, eventually what we are discussing a crime only. Just the medium and the context and the way it is performed is different from the normal crime. Eventually, if I just want to, you know, conclude to that, it's just a crime in fact. At the end, we are just analyzing a crime, but the platform and the context it is produced is different. That's what makes that thin line of difference between crime and the cyber crime discussions, right? So please, whatever we have, you know, understood or referred till now, do actually keep on revising it, because those are the terms which you maybe, you know, will also see in the upcoming digital chapters also, right? Even though we are moving our attention towards digital aspects, but you will see those terms quite often in that aspect also. And that's the reason it is important to understand about crimes in general also. And moreover, to add up a value that what actually, you know, makes this underlining term of forensics and cybercrime different is the fact that if we are actually talking about forensics in general, it's all about that you know about a particular technology, such as just say basic example of Windows, right? So what all you have been doing is you have been just studying the technical aspect, okay? Just the technical aspect, that if you have given a Windows system, what are the different ways to actually extract the forensic artifacts? That's all what forensic is all about. That's all, right? Now, yeah, there are some standards also playing a role over there. But the only thing that you are concerned or you are bothered about is a specific technology such as Windows operating system, and actually just, you know, put your hands over it and just extract the forensic artifacts in a different way and just try to analyze if there is any anti-forensic technique applied or not and extract more and more things over there. But again, on the other hand, cybercrime is not just in dealing with forensics, but it's moreover a whole process. Okay, cybercrime I'm talking. It's moreover a whole process which not just deals with actually extraction of those artifacts, but it also deals with other legal aspects, other intervention aspects, other critical aspects, psychological aspects altogether. Right? So this is what the underlining term is about the cyber crime, which is differing from the field of forensics, right? Now coming to the thing, today we are actually going to move our attention towards digital evidence. Till now, we all have been talking about evidence in general, general evidence that we see in case of general crimes, correct? But we are actually going to continue on the same track, right? But only the context will be different. That's the only difference, right? It's just like you're reading the same book, right? But the chapter is different. That's all. So we have been actually talking about, till today also we'll be talking about, you can say, digital evidence, okay? But in the terms of digital, yeah, that's what. We'll be talking about evidence only, but in terms of digital evidence and not no more general evidence. Okay. So, well, I guess there is only one PDF module that we are going to refer today for our class. And well, I guess till that time, the class timing also will be winded up because it's a long, big PDF. And if still some time persists, we can end up the class quickly today. It's completely all right because it's okay to go slow rather than to, you know, go fast and try to clutter up the things. And there is no point in, you know, finishing the course fast. I want you all to be my learners for much long period, right? So that's all. Coming back to the point. So it's a part of third module itself, but within this third module itself, we are actually talking about evidence collection, preservation, and all those other things. But in this third module itself, we actually move our attention towards handling of digital evidence, right? So now, whatever we'll be talking, it will be in terms of digital, not in general, okay? So as I said yesterday and day before yesterday also, that slowly, steadily, right, just like the tortoise in the rabbit and the tortoise story, we're actually slowly and steadily going to completely divert our attention towards digital evidences and not general crime scenes. So let's get started. Now, digital evidence is volatile. To be very precise, it's not only volatile, but it's highly volatile and highly fragile. And improper handling of this evidence can alter it, right? Because of its volatility and fragility, protocols need to be followed to ensure that it is not modified during its handling. That is, during its access, collection, packing, transfer, and storage. During this entire process. Now, if you have actually understood the previous chapters correctly, you can see I have been, you know, telling you since the last two or three classes that understanding crime in general is important. Understanding crime in general is important, regardless of whether it is applicable or not. As a PI, it is important. Why? Because here you can see these are the same processes that we have been studying, right? Previously, in terms of general evidences, access, collection, packing and transfer and storage, right? So as I said, crime in general is important to understand because many of its aspects are actually going to compile with digital evidences also. Because at the end, we are not talking about digital forensics. We are actually talking about crime only. Just add the term cyber. The medium of the crime is different, right? So while actually handling digital evidence also, it is important to note that it is not altered or modified or tampered in any way, starting from its access stage up till collection, packing, transfer, and up till storing that evidence, right? These protocols delineate the steps to be followed while handling the digital evidence. There are four phases involving in the initial handling of digital evidence: identification, collection, acquisition, and preservation. Yeah, excuse me. So we are actually going to deep dive in these four steps or in these four phases today. So today's class will all be about these four phases in terms of digital evidences: identification, collection, acquisition, and preservation. Okay. So let us start with the identification phase. In the identification phase, the preliminary information is obtained about the cybercrime case prior to collecting the digital evidence. This preliminary information is similar to that which is sought during a traditional crime investigation, right? Again, this point is adding a value to what I'm been saying, right? For crime in general. The investigator, in the identification phase, what the investigator tries to seek, the answer to the following questions: that who, what, when, where, and how. And if you can recall the very first class of our batch, okay, which was around 2-3 days ago, I don't even, 3 days ago on first, right? The very first term and the very first statement that I've been using in the first class is that as an investigator in cyber crime or in traditional crime also, we have to be familiar with the WH question series, right? So in identification phase of digital evidence, again, those WH questions are important. And who, what phase actually helps us to identify these WH questions? By the name, it says identification phase. That who, what, how, when, and why. Right? Where, sorry, not why. Where? The answers to this question will provide investigators with guidance on how to proceed with the case. For example, the answer to the question, where did this crime occur? That is within, outside the country, or within the country's border. Just a general example it is given. The where question or these kind of questions is actually dynamic depending upon the case that you have been involved. Now, before the digital evidence collection begins, the investigator must define the types of evidence sought. Digital evidence can be found on digital devices such as computers, external hard drives, flash drives, routers, smartphones, tablets, cameras, TVs, internet-enabled home appliances, that is IoT, social media artifacts falling under the open source, that is OSINT information, whether that we get via social media, publicly available information, etc. The evidence sought will depend upon the cyber crime, which is actually under investigation phase. If the crime under investigation is identity-related fraud, just as an example, then the digital evidence that are seized will be searched for the evidence of this crime. With respect to cyber crime, the crime scene is not limited to the physical location of the digital devices used in the commissions of the cyber crime and or that were the target of the cyber crime. The cyber crime scene also includes digital evidences that potentially hold digital evidence and spans multiple digital device systems and servers, etc. The crime scene is secured when a cyber crime is observed, reported or suspected. The first responder, again, you see the general crime phase term over here is used. The first responder identifies and protects the crime scene from contamination and preserves the volatile evidence by isolating the users of all digital devices found at the crime scene, right? And this is something which I can completely relate to. The reason I have been saying this, because I'm working as a freelance, you can say, probably as in title, as an intervention officer. Okay, so I'm not much dealing with the cyber crime scene, but actually moreover I'm dealing with the cyber crime victims which are involved in the scene, and the mental, the emotional, and the other states, as well as dealing with the technicalities that are involved, right? So, to be very honest, I'm actually, you can say, into the list of COP Connect by National Security Database, NSD, as an authorized first responder, also called as the intervention officer, right? So, I can very much relate it to this, actually the term that has been used over here, right? So actually my job is not to isolate the crime scene from contamination. That is more of a less, yes it is, but the primarily area for my you could say serving as an first responder or an intervention officer is to actually deal with the victim itself first. So here, what I'm trying to say is, it's not always in terms of cyber world that the first responder is only responsible for preventing the contamination. It could also be in the form of actually dealing with the victims. And, providing and context to other aspects in terms of the victim and the crime and the issues that the victim is facing. To be very precise, such as cyber psychological influences, etc. Now, there is the typo over here. It's not he, it is T-H-E, the. The users must not be given the opportunity to further operate the digital evidences. Neither should the first responder nor the investigator seek the assistance of any user during the search in the documentation process. The investigator, if different from the first responder, searches the crime scene and identifies the evidence, right? Before the evidence is collected, the crime scene is documented. So in my case, if I'm talking about, here it is saying that if there is a different first responder and different investigator, so the first it will be documented. In my case, more often I'm both. I'm serving as a first responder also, and I'm an investigator also. So both are the things that I have to tackle, because should include detailed information about the digital evidence is collected, including the operational state of the device, on, off, standby mode, etc., its physical characteristics such as make, model, serial number, connections, and any markings or other damage that is being found on this devices. The investigator or the crime scene technician collects the evidence. The collection procedures, okay, so what are we actually, if someone knocked up, we actually long ago moved into the collection phase, right? So the investigator or the crime scene technician collects the evidence. The identity, the collection procedure vary depending upon the type of digital device and the public and private resources where the evidence resides. Law enforcement agencies have a standard operating procedure. In short, you also know it as an SOP that actually details the steps to be taken when handling digital evidence. A standard operating procedure, SOP, is designed to assist investigators by including the policies and the sequential acts that should be followed to investigate cyber crime in a manner that ensures the admissibility of the collected evidence in a court of law, as well as the tools and the other resources needed to conduct the investigation. To be honest, we're actually going to talk a lot about the admissibility of the digital evidence also. Maybe tomorrow or a day after, depending upon this particular chapter. Okay. At the same time, we'll also be actually observing and gaining insights from the standard operating procedures, the SOPs that are being actually designed by various agencies. To be specific, in case of US, there are a lot of agencies that actually do have a standard SOP that is generalized in many of the areas or aspects, even used by the private investigators, right, in order to assist the investigations. One of them actually could be the US Department of Homeland Security or the NIST frameworks. And for India, if I'm specifically talking, then DSCI, Data Security Council of India, has actually made a cyber crime investigation manual, which we are actually going to have a go through of that also in the upcoming modules. And a few of the context will be also be taken from that manual also, regarding the SOP standards and all. We are going to also going to look have a look on that, right? And now I am aware of this fact because personally I have been dealing with privacy and all, as I have undergone through the training of DCPLA, that is Privacy Lead Accessor under DSCI, right? So we'll actually be looking on those aspects too. We'll be touching those areas too. But whatever is relevant asked for the collection phase now is the fact that this is how the collection phase is actually taken care of. So in collection phase, SOP is mandate, because depending upon the SOPs or the regulation frameworks and all, it is the mandate thing, because it decides the admissibility of the evidence, or you could say the evidentiary value in the court of law. Unique constraints that could be encountered during investigation should be identified. For example, cybercrime investigators could encounter multiple digital devices, operating systems, and complex network configurations, which will require specialized knowledge, variation in collection procedures, and assisting in identifying connections between systems and devices. And this is why actually you can say it is actually impossible for someone to provide a deep context for forensic as well as cybercrime, due to the variations that are being present in the devices, the technology, the way it is being stored, collected, analyzed, preserved, etc. That's the reason it's very actually tough to provide an in-context, in-depth thing combining forensics and cybercrime. That's the reason in our case also, we to give a general example of our own company, we have been dealing with different courses for cybercrime, a different course for Windows Forensics, a different course for Linux Forensics, is the fact that this is what matters in the collection phase, because everything cannot be provided, right? Even a certification such as CHFI that deals with forensic a lot and has a lot of forensic artifacts, knowledges pertaining in it, but still, you won't find a complete deep dive into all those areas, right? There will be some part of Windows Forensics, there will be some part of Cloud Forensics, there will be some part of Linux Forensics, but there won't be a specific deep dive into Windows Forensics. There won't be a specific deep dive into Linux Forensics. That is the reason it is important to know about these terms. Regarding the collection phase, this is what actually, you know, is making this diversification of the cybercrime and the digital forensic needs. Various anti-forensic techniques may also get encountered during an investigation. The actions taken by the investigators in this case, if any, depends on the national laws. The actual collection of evidence involves the preservation of volatile evidence and powering down of the digital evidence, digital devices. The state of operation of the digital devices encountered will dictate to the collection procedures. What actually this point is trying to say is, it's more of dealing in terms of volatile evidence and dealing in terms of the digital devices which are actually either powered off or are powered on. And what to do in that case? For instance, if a computer is encountered and if the device is on, volatile evidence such as temporary files, register, cache, and the network status and the connections, to name a few. Example, it could be the memory also, right? RAM is preserved before powering down the device and collecting it. So live acquisition is made in that cases. If the source is off, then it will remain off, and special collection strategies such as again live acquisition is adopted to extract the evidences. Because even if we power it on, the moment we power it on, there could be some certain artifacts that may be altered. In addition to the digital devices, other relevant items such example notes, notebooks that might include passwords or other information about online credentials, telephones, fax machines, printers, etc., routers, etc., should be collected as well. The actions taken by the investigator during the collection of evidence should be documented. Again, a typo over here. It's each device should be labeled along with its connecting labels and power cords, like just to name a few as an examples, packaged and transported back to a digital forensic laboratory. So, before moving on to the acquisition phase, any doubts for identification and the collection phases? Well, I guess it shouldn't be, because it's clearly straight, it's clearly, lightened up to the exact terms that it should. So could could you just, give a thumbs up or something so that, we will move on to the acquisition phase then. Okay, I've got a thumbs up. Let's get started with the acquisition phase then. I'm assuming that as of now, there are no doubts in regards to the collection and the identification phases. Now, coming to the acquisition phase. Different approaches to performing acquisition exist, similar to the collection and identifications. The approach taken depends upon the type of digital evidence. Again, this point is similar to the first two phases. For example, the procedure for acquiring digital evidence from a computer hard drive is different from the procedure required to obtain digital evidence from a mobile device, such as a smartphone. At a forensic laboratory, digital evidence should be acquired in a manner that preserves the integrity of the evidence. Again, here we are talking about the integrity of the evidence and the evidentiary value, just as we talked about the evidences of the general crimes. To achieve this, the tools and the techniques used to acquire digital evidence must prevent alterations, preserve the evidence in a proper format, right? And the data should not be tampered when it is not possible. At least, you know, if it's not possible to, prevent alterations, at least, you know, we need to minimize the risk of alteration and tampering, right? And those methods and those protocols must be reliable and verified. And again, in the SOPs, there are a lot of, protocols and the pointers that deal with the acquisition phase, which are actually reliable. Just to note a few, for example, if I'm talking about the acquisition phase, here is an example of the US National Institute of Standards and Technology, NIST. Now, if you are into forensics, if you are into cybercrime, and if you don't know about the NIST, or if you're not following the regulation standards for NIST, means you stand nowhere. Not even talking about forensics or cyber crime. Talking about the various security services also that have been designed. For example, the CEH courses, other, reputed courses. The content actually is designed as per the NIST frameworks and the regulations, right? Let's talk in general in terms of the acquisition phase only. The US National Institute of Standards and Technology, that is NIST, has a searchable digital forensics tool database with the tools of various functionalities, such as cloud forensics, among others, etc., mentioned on their websites. Okay. Those, if you're using those procedures, I mean, that is the only admissible and acceptable. Okay. So, if I just go in over here. You can see NIST Digital Forensic Standards. I think there is on one on the website also, which is also NIST Forensic Tools. Tool catalog, I think. Yeah, this is a different PDF. Yeah, see, this is what I was talking about. For example, disk imaging. Choose, you could say the host. If I talk about Windows, supported evidence interfaces, you can choose over here. And if I just click on search, Atola Insight Forensics, result 1 of 15, result Belcasoft Evidence Center. Data recovery system, then there are a lot of tools, DTCO Ultimate Suite, Forensic Replicator, Magnet Acquire, Magnet Axiom, OS Forensics by Passmark. I have personally done the OSFCT certification, OS Forensics Triad certification, and PC3000 Data Extractor, Super Image, Autopsy, and all those things also will be present, although like it's an open source also, Autopsy. Is it the same for disk imaging? Which software? Yeah. Generally, the imaging softwares do have cloning also. Although, if I just talk about disk cloning, then in a practical standards, if applicable, instead of relying on a software utility, there are specialized disk cloners in form of a hardware utility. Okay, which is actually preferred to use. So, if I just say about hardware disk cloner, you can see Just like there is one slot to put in the, you could say, the disk that you want to clone, and the other slot is for the empty disk which you want to replicate with, and the clone process will be done. So for cloning, generally, for the regulatory standards and all, if applicable, it is suggested to use a hardware disk cloner. Yeah. That's like you can see common tools are not even mentioned. Yeah, that's true. But yeah, this is how it actually works. Because NIST is followed and repeated, right? Now it all depends on which tools you are using, but the value is already, you can say not to be correct. It's not the term that, you know, other tools are not valid or applicable, but you can say the tools listed on the NIST, we could say are recognized, and you can say the value of that evidence is considered to be superior and that the evident review that I'm talking about, right? So this is how it's working, right? And it's all about this, how the system is working, and all we can do is actually, you know, go with the system rather than thinking of changing the system, which probably we, you and me alone cannot do anything. Right? To be honest, if I'm talking about my own personal perspectives, I am very big fond of the open source forensic tools. Number one, yeah, they do require knowledge and a bit of manual upskilling, right? But the only point is they do yield the same results as the professional softwares, which actually cost in lakhs and lakhs of dollars and rupees. So TF, this cloning will be done with other tools, and it is not what legit. It is legit, but then again, it will may it may be said that it's deteriorating the evidentiary value, and in certain cases, then it may not be admissible to the court. And sir, that's the reason, right? Even after having so much of softwares and all those other things, yeah, it's completely biased. And that's the reason, even after having, you know, so much of softwares and, you know, companies working on this, still the investigation, when you talk about law enforcement also or private sector also, you will find similar set of tools, right? If you just, you know, think over it, and if you could agree to this point, right, I could get a thumbs up, right? You'll find a similar set of tools. The agency is different. The type of crime that they are dealing is maybe different, but again, more or less, the tools that are been taken in use will be the same or similar, and that's the reason you know, this is happening. That's the reason you are seeing the similarity in the tools and all, even though the procedures or the sectors may be different, such as law enforcement or the private one. And there are, this could be overpriced. Sir, these tools could be not. They are actually overpriced. It's not something they could be. They are overpriced. Because if it could be, where I've been working as an R&D associate, the private company, it's a private investigation organization, right? Over there, we do actually have, if I just talk about, see, I have the tool name also. Mobile Edit Forensic Suit. I mean, I was literally shocked to actually realize that we do really have it. This is one of the most reputed tool for mobile forensics. And I'm not sure whether the pricing is given over here or not. Buy now. Now this is for single phone, Express Standard and Express Pro. Sir, for the regulation, there is no specific restriction on, owning this tool. as a PI, even if in as a general PI, not even having an organization, you can actually own this tool. Yeah, private sector can. That's what I'm saying, sir. My own private company where I've been working as an R&D associate, they have this tool. Right. So it's not something that they are. Yeah, there are certain tools which are completely to the standards for law enforcement agencies. Right. Which are not at all allowed to touch by the private sectors, especially if I'm talking about in India, or if you could just highlight the tools for CDR analysis and all. It is something where a private sector cannot interfere. But tools like this, to be very honest, more than law enforcement, you will find it in the private sectors. And private sectors actually do deal with these tools and utilize these tools in a better way when compared to law enforcement agencies also. And at least in India, if I'm talking, the blind opinion, I'm not, you know, against the law enforcement agencies. I do respect them, right? But the ultimate point is they have been just given the software, which is in lakhs, right? Which is in dollars, expensive. They have not been given any background technicality of using the thing and how it is working. All they have been told is just, you know, do this click, do a click over there, do this click, 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 and done. And this is the truth, at least in India. I'm honest. That's the reason, you know, I'm saying that, you know, private sectors, in fact, are using and utilizing these kind of tools in an efficient way rather than the law enforcement agencies. And I'm not sure this could be the scenario in case of US also, but more or less is still the same, I guess, everywhere around the globe. And that's the reason I'm again making an opinion from my own personal perspective and experience, that I do love the open source forensic, the open source DFIR area very much, because open source tools are not exactly the same. You can say the similar, but more or less they yield the same results. Yeah, exactly. Right. So, any more doubts? What I'll do is I'll just share. Where is that page? NIST Tool Navigator. Here it is. I'll be sharing the link for this also in the chat.
This is not forensics, sir. This isn't forensics.
Are these tools updated at all? Now, let me first ask you. Sir, are you talking about the tool in general? Are you talking about the tool navigator of NIST? Both. So in terms of actually, it's correlated. It's not, you cannot consider them as different. The reason I'm saying this is because even though you can say there are not a quite updated or new tools that are available in the industry out there, which could be cheap or could be free, also listed out over here. But whatever are listed on the NIST, you can say out of 10, I'm just considering a ratio of 10, out of 10, eight tools or eight tool providers or the companies that you will find which are actually keeping their tools updated. So even if the NIST is not updating the tool list, but the existing tool list and the vendors of the tools, out of 10, you'll find at least 6 to 7 at minimum, the vendors who are actually updating their tools frequently. So for example, if I'm talking about this mobile edit forensics, it's not something that it is, it's an old tool. You could say it's a biased decision that, you know, NIST is recommending to use this, but it, mobile edit forensics, it's one of the most reputed company for mobile forensics. I've been not using, but I've been seeing and hearing about this software a lot in my own private organization, wherein the investigator in charge have to do nothing, sir, nothing. Just insert the mobile, click a button, and everything will be done, automated, right? So, yeah, it works in vice versa, both the cases. Right. So he cannot say that it is outdated. Yeah, mostly consider yearly subscriptions which supports an update. Exactly. What kind of forensic could be done on mobile? We'll come to that, sir. We'll come to that module also. Because I won't be deeping dive into it. Because number one, we are directly targeting the forensic field. And number two, it is in the upcoming context of the course, right? Yes. Now, to be honest, NIST more in terms of is followed in US because it's of US, but it's not only followed in US. Trust me, NIST is a global recognized, you can say, globally recognized, you can say. So this tool navigator specifically doesn't even apply on US, but it does apply throughout the entire globe. Right. Moving further into this acquisition phase. Okay. The seized digital devices are considered as the primary source of evidence. The digital forensic analyst does not acquire data from the primary source. Instead, a duplicate is made of the content of the device and the analyst works on the copy. Is the basic rule for acquisition. This duplicate copy of the content of the digital device, which is known as an image, is created before a static acquisition is conducted to maintain the integrity of the digital evidence. And by law or by the legislature, by the legal norms, or even by the admissibility of the evidence or the evidentiary value, whatever you term, it is actually not applicable to, you know, work on the direct copy also, on the original copy. To verify whether the duplicate copy is an exact copy of the original, a cryptographic hash value is calculated for the original and the duplicate using mathematical computations. If they match, the copy's content are mirror image, that is a duplicate of the original content. And this is actually very easy. It is done by the automated tools. So whenever, you know, the tool through which we are actually, you know, creating or generating this image, they do actually have an inbuilt option for hashing, you know, looking out the hash also. The hash could be in terms of MD5 or SHA-256. Also now, which is the hash, it again depends that which hash is actually admissible in the court of law, depending upon the region that you're talking about. And to be specific, in India, I think MD5 is applicable and there is also SHA-126. Yeah. I'll come to that also. We'll discuss that also in the later part, but I'm still, you know, mentioning as a point over here. SHA-256. Thank you so much, sir. So in India, SHA-256 actually is considered to be admissible in the court of law. Okay. So even if you just, you know, talk that other hash is more provide a good or intact evidentiary value, still it is not admissible. Because SHA-256 means SHA-256, none other than that. It's there. A write blocker which is designed to prevent the alteration of the data was obtained, what evidence was obtained, and for what reason. So again, WH series of questions. So the document should answer these WH series questions. Evidence preservation seeks to protect digital evidence from modification. So we are actually at the preservation phase now. Okay, preservation phase starts. Evidence preservation. Just wait. It's already 11:25. And there are a lot of slides to go. So what say, shall we conclude over here? And see the preservation and reporting phase is tomorrow. What happens when law enforcement can't extract info from device? Does it ask private commercial companies for help, or it's only government involved? Depends on the enforcement and the resources available for the enforcement agencies. To be very honest, sir, if I'm talking about India, because I'm working for a private company closely, I'm an employee over there, I can easily lead to your question. To be honest, there are a lot of scenarios where the law enforcement agencies are not able to crack it up. Trust me, there are a lot of cases where they have been coming to private organizations like us or other private organizations who are specialized or who have much more insight of what they are doing, rather than just, you know, clicking a few buttons of the tool, right? On the other hand, what could be a possible scenario again is they directly actually approach the vendor or another vendor who would actually help them to do so, rather than a private investigation company. Right? So the vendor of the tool, exactly. So now, Khiladi sir, you are absolutely on point, especially in OSINT cases, in terms of social engineering, in terms of OSINT. Law enforcement agencies do not have that, you can say, what can I call, knowledge. I'm sorry if it's going against the, you could say, policies, right? It may sound rude, but yeah, it's there, okay? It's there. Don't have the appropriate knowledge. And not, it's not about the knowledge, it's only about, you know, I'll be very honest, that things happening in India, the high-end officers that are working on superior positions such as superintendent and inspector generals and all, they are the ones who are considered to be CISO of the police departments. But on the other end, if I'm talking about the local agencies, local areas, then constables also are, you know, kept in the cybercrime wing. And they are just, you know, told how to do this click and how to do that click. Right. So,
yes.
And sir, that's the reason, you know, yesterday I told about that I have been working with Maharashtra Cyber also, which is the cyber crime wing for the Maharashtra state where I've been residing. Why? The reason they have been taking people like us for OSINT, right? Because they know where they are standing as of now. Exactly. Most private companies works on the basis of R&D, and that's the reason I'm able to relate quite a lot of things over here, because I'm an R&D associate only in my private company. Position where I'm working as an R&D associate. Cool, that's, and trust me, R&D, by the name, how it sounds cool, R&D research and development, it is actually a cool field to work in, especially in private sectors. Because I don't consider the R&D done by the agent enforcement sectors is to be termed as R&D also. To be very honest, I'm sorry for that, but yeah, that's the truth. Because it comes to, is this on contract basis? Depends again, it could be on contract basis or else it could be on the basis of the case also, or for a single case, on that specific case, only for that basis, that's all. Could government force you? Force in terms of what, sir? For what they'll force us? Could you just provide a light in terms of what force? To help them out? No, they cannot. Not at all. Not at all they can force. It's completely up to the decision of the private agency whether to opt in or opt out. Simply, they'll actually, you know, you could say, opting some other agency then. Then you have relation. Yeah, agreement is signed, MOUs are signed, contract is signed, confidentiality agreements are signed. You can say at the same time, it depends on the case. for, it's not something, sir, to be very specific, it's not that it's always a contract such as a yearly or half yearly or fortnightly something. It's simply based on a case. It depends from case to case then. If on for a case, it's not subjectable to law enforcement agencies, they'll approach us for that specific case only. Rather than signing up a contract for a long-term period, not at all. No, you actually will never be working for government. You will be working for company confidentially. Yeah. I actually didn't got exactly what are you trying to say over here, but
could you just put on I'll explain.
Yeah, yeah.
Actually, here, like, you know, whenever even I worked in a company, I was part of it. I will not tell what and all. But there actually, we worked with multiple organizations, even like government and different sectors. Mm-hmm. First of all, to maintain the confidentiality, they will never ever tell you who is the client or who is actually what. If they are telling you, because you will be having multiple friends,
multiple
you may be discussing and it will break the whole entire process. The sensitivity of the particular project. So that's why I told.
The data outreaching source, the company will be blamed then.
Absolutely. Because here the sensitivity of the project, you never know. Like maybe some of the person, they will be particularly taking interest in that particular case. They may leak the information in any way. So that will be confidentially used. So that's why I told you, never will, you never know, like you are working for government or not. They, you will be just getting a assigned product, project. Okay, this is the email you need to do that, OSINT or
exactly,
you need to crack
exactly,
or whatever.
Exactly.
That's it.
And this was the same experience when I was actually working with this Maharashtra Cyber. I'll be very honest. To be honest, you could say, Sam, sir, if I'm talking about adding to point what Khiladi sir have said, okay. To be very honest, in India, it's said that stay away from power people. And these kind of agencies, the people over here, they are known as power people. Today, they'll say you are a, you know, just go on. We are friends. We are together. The next morning, you're like, who are you? And you will, they'll actually be the ones who will take you behind the bars. So it's very, very, you know, you can say, what we call it as now, I am not getting the exact term, you know, it's not, it's very unstabilized, you can say, the system over here. It's completely an unstabilized system. Number one, because you are a fellow, how they can trust you, number one. Even if you are, you know, working since a long, quite long period, still, you, they can actually, to be very honest, I'm using the term, they can actually kick you out at any point of time.
Especially, if in a private company, like entry is not that easy.
Exactly.
I know,
entry is not that easy.
Easy. Because first of all, you will be clearing so many background verifications, especially then you will be trustworthy. They will found you everything. Then only they will allow you to work in a company because it's matter of confidentiality again. If it's breaking, then everything will be breaking. Even it comes to the national security as well.
Right.
So,
on the other hand,
like,
for
you never
the government,
know, yeah.
It is easy to join and it is easy to leave also because they may only kick you out.
Yes, yes, yes. But in private companies, actually, you will be having multiple and good hands-on, like in very good way. Even like you will be having a free hand to do R&D.
Yeah, and R&D is most of the prestigious wing when it comes to private companies, especially dealing with investigations.
Yes.
R&D is one of the most prestigious wing over there. I have been observing this closely. And to be honest, if I'm talking, Sam sir, if I'm talking, adding to the, my own experience over there, it was. So when I was been working with this, of you know, government sectors, again, I won't take the names. Okay. Initially, till the time of work, okay, remote, it was remote work. They are only interested in what is the outcome. All the credit was being sucked by the officers, to be honest. And at the end of my journey, when I actually, you know, opted out from that. Okay. They were the actually ones who didn't even remember my name. And they were the ones who actually, you know, got some misconfusion regarding the things I did. And they imposed pressures from the local enforcement agencies. Just guess, sir, a person who we've been working for them. And at the end, criticizing that same person. This is the scenario of law enforcement agency, at least in India.
Yes, that's common.
Yeah. So that's more often, if you see in India, more often the side will be taken for the private sector. And we are actually going to discuss a lot of reasons. Probably you know a lot of them, that why then people actually believe in private sector rather than their law enforcement agency. Even a common people, even a single victim of cybercrime. I'm not even talking about a corporate or a company. If there is a one victim of cybercrime, he or she, to be specifically, will actually restrict to go to the law enforcement agencies. Right. So, well, I guess, you know, we had a good debate today on, you know, quite a lot of things. Right. And we'll complete the collection and the reporting phase tomorrow. Preservation and the reporting phase tomorrow. Okay. It's already 11:35, and I'll meet you tomorrow at the same time, 10:30 p.m. IST. For the ones in India, have a good night. For the ones outside, have a good day. Meet you tomorrow. Thank you. Thanks for joining.
Yeah. Good night. Bye-bye.
Good night. Bye.